Roof, come hang out with us because we have a new friend who's joined us, our senior MBA writer, Ramona Shelburne. I know it's insider, but I like calling you a writer because, you know, writer. There you go. Thank you for joining us.
That's right.
You're out of the club.
You got a basis.
Definitely not. I can barely read, let alone write.
Exactly. Well, yeah, I didn't want to say that on national TV, but the secret's out. No, Kevin Durant was always supposed to be reevaluated today after that left calf strain, so the Warriors not expecting him to be back, but you've got an update on whether it's official.
Yeah, I mean, he's going to officially be reevaluated before the game, but he's not close. And Rachel, I saw him yesterday coming out of the Warriors practice facility, and he was wearing some flip-flops. He had a slight limp still. From what I understand, all he's been able to really do is upper body work and his rehab, and so he's, you know, a source described it as not close. So you can count him out for tonight. Again, not close. So I
don't
know
really
how close he is
to me, right? Because we knew he wasn't going to play. And and after the game in Houston, Game 6, I was asking some of the Warriors senior officials. I said, "All right, if you guys go up in the series, does that extend the timeline for Kevin?" And they made it clear to me, like, "Hey, if we're winning, why would we rush him back?" Right? Which is, of course, common sense. That being said, calf strains can really vary, right?
That's
the most mild version is 7 to 10 days. It can leave you out for a month, which is a very different sort of thing. They've never really told us the severity of this injury. Have you gotten a sense if he's not close? Is it on the more severe end?
Yeah, I mean, like, there's a couple of benchmarks you have to hit, right? So you have to at least get back on the court to do something basketball related.
Right.
Okay.
Step one, you have to be able to walk without a limp.
Correct. So if all he's doing right now is, like, he takes the ropes and he's doing upper body, staying in shape. But if that's all he's doing, that means you're not even close to getting back on the court to doing basketball related.
That to me is sort of a little red light of we got to watch this,
Malcolm Brogdon with his plantar fasciitis and they had the tear. He was still doing on the court stuff for weeks before he ever played a game.
Yeah.
Right. So it's like there is benchmarks, like Ramona said, that there's benchmarks that you have to hit and that you have to get to. So if he's not even touching any of those benchmarks, he's a lot further away than I think people think.
But here's the other thing. They played 13 players in game one. 13 That's players in a playoff game?
Yeah.
I mean, they're getting rest for all their starters right now.
The Blazers. Are you a little insulted about that? Because Steve Kerr made it so clear that against the Rockets, he's like, "I can only trust these guys. I'm starting the Hamptons five." Yeah. And after the game, this game, he goes, "We feel this is a series we can play more of our guys."
Yeah, I mean, in the Rockets series, they played their starters averaged almost 40 minutes a game.
Yeah.
That's a lot of minutes for your starters to be averaging, but they had to lean that heavily on them.
Well,
and in the first game of this series against Portland, Klay Thompson was the high-minute guy at 37.
Right. Well, I mean, look, it's up to the Blazers. If you don't like it, make them change it. Make it different. Time to play one of our other favorite games on the jump, Something, Nothing, or Everything. Shout out Kevin Wilds. Let's take a look here. Guys, Ramona, the fact that Zion hasn't hired an agent yet, Something, Nothing, or Everything.
I think that's something.
What?
The biggest thing for Zion, though, was the shoe contract. And I think, you know, it's great for the New Orleans Pelicans if they won the lottery, but he doesn't have a shoe contract done. And if he would have had that done before the draft, you still have the possibility of going to one of the biggest markets in the country. Now you don't. You're in one of the smallest markets in the country. And by not getting that shoe contract done, I had one industry source tell me they think it might have cost him $20, $25 million.
Well, it could, because if you get it done before the draft, hey, he's the number one pick. Now, again, that's a small timeline. That's a small timeline to negotiate what could be a $50 to $200 million deal. It's a very small timeline. And so a lot of times –
Duke get knocked out of the
That's what I'm saying.
Because it's been a while.
But shoe companies will wait.
Yeah.
Shoe companies were like, "Hey, we'll wait to see what's going on, especially with number one pick." Ultimately, it doesn't matter where Zion's going to go. Everyone's going to want him, but there could be some tweaks. But as far as I say it's nothing, mainly because he's the number one pick.
Right.
He doesn't need to give an agent 4% right now. So as far as his contract stuff, there's number one pick, and then eventually in 4 years, if he stays healthy and everything's good, it's going to be max. So you don't need to give an agent 4% of stuff that you're already doing. It's just shoe contracts and stuff, but there's a lot more. It's a lot more nuanced than
think about that 4% is everything is negotiable.
And that's certainly true, too.
Yes, including zero.
Right.
Including zero. And so it's like, if you don't have to do that, so it puts you in a spot. Like, if you have a big-time agent, you could be in a spot where you need his help. So, like, a lot of these agents, it could be Clutch. It could be Rock. It could be
CAA. But maybe
CAA.
He doesn't, to your point, maybe he doesn't need that for a few years.
You don't
we'll
need
have to
that
see
yet.
If he goes out and gets a big agent, some sort of agent, maybe an agent on a reduced commission.
Yeah.
Our Nick DiPaola has come on the jump and said he does expect a bidding war for Zion services. So that could drive the price up, even though he is playing in a smaller market. And I'm going to keep saying it. Russell Westbrook has made the point. He plays in Oklahoma City. He has a huge shoe contract, and he has had a bunch of national commercials on TV. Well, so size of market doesn't always dictate.
Size of market doesn't matter when you are a transcendent superstar who has multiple, who has an MVP and multiple All-Star appearances under your belt.
Yeah.
Zion doesn't have all that yet.
Yeah.
So Zion has a great college career so far.
He does, but he also
1 year in college.
But he also has a brand that no one has had since LeBron came in. Mm-hmm. Right. There hasn't been where it's like he's going to get endorsement deals before he ever plays. He's going to have commercials for a brand before he ever plays a game in the NBA. Not many guys get those opportunities because his social media following, people have been following since high school. Everything. So that he's just a little bit different in a lot of ways.
All right, let's move on to Kawhi Leonard. He has his own shoe deal, New Balance. There you go. He also has, he had his league best 830-point game in the postseason last night, but really quiet in the second half, Richard, shooting 5 of 15, scoring 2 points in the fourth quarter alone. Is that something, nothing, or everything?
I think it's something. I think you need to be able to give this guy a little bit of a break. And again, we talked about Kyle Lowry and him playing so well and you wanting to maximize that. But I think Kawhi, we talked about it earlier. You play 2 months of basketball, you're going to have an off game. He hasn't had many of them.
But he scored 30.
Yeah, he still scored 30. And so he was basically on pace for, low 40s, but he just kind of fell short a little bit. But I think he's going to be fine. This was a bad 10-minute stretch for them in this fourth quarter.
If you're going to be 6 of 9 versus 0 of 3, you want the 6 of 9 in the game 7.
And by the way, when was that game 7 in Philadelphia?
Yeah, exactly.
Not a lot of recovery time in between if you're going to have any kind of – I mean, he's been sitting out quite a bit this year for load management.
Let's get to the much more important story of this series. Let's not kid ourselves. There's a Milwaukee radio station, 103.7 KISS FM. They've announced – during this series, they are not playing any Drake songs until Bucks Raptors is over. Richard, is the Drake boycott by Milwaukee's radio station something, nothing, or everything?
Oh, it's everything. Do you know how difficult it is to replace 30% of your catalog?
Right.
Like Drake
songs,
like,
songs he's guested it's on.
Everything. That's 30% of everybody's catalog. Everybody's iTunes, Spotify. Most of them have Drake on it. So, yeah, that's going to be tough.
Producer Danny just said in my ear, Drake has more number one hits than the Beatles.
Whoa.
Oh, wow. Here we go. Streaming.
Here's the question. Like, we don't know. Like, so far, Drake has sort of been a curse for the Raptors, right? Like, he hasn't worked.
Just the Raptors?
I wasn't going to go that far, but if you want to. I mean, and we know that there is a curse of Little B, so I feel like these two.
There are a lot of curses.
Working.
I
don't know. I do feel like Drake's had a good sense of humor about the curse thing, right? With some of the stuff he's posted on social. I am curious to see how this goes for both sides. I think this is the most important. Forget Giannis. Forget Kawhi. Definitely most important story of this series. All right, coming up, what needs to change for the Blazers tonight in Game 2? Richard has some ideas. First, though, it's time for our other distant replay. This is 1997, so it's not you, Richard.
Thanks.
It's Grandmama!
Oh, Grandmama?
Yes.
Oh, my favorite.
Oh, let's get it.
Underneath Johnson.
Oh, wow.
I think Grandmama and all the dunks, people don't understand how talented Larry Johnson was. Larry Johnson was a special player.
And if you don't know what we're talking about, plus this week, Kobe breaks down Warriors forward Draymond Green's multidimensional play. Start your free trial of ESPN Plus right now by downloading the app. And it's crunch time here on The Jump. Magic Johnson and Larry Bird, claps for them.
Yeah.
They received Lifetime Achievement Awards at this year's NBA Awards, June 24th in Santa Monica. Richard, they wanted to have these at your house. They had to have them a little bit up at the beach.
Yeah.
So one-on-one right now, Lifetime opponents, if they had to go against each other, not in college, not in the pros, but right now, who you got?
I still got Magic. I think Magic is probably moving a little better. Bird, at the end, his back was so bad, and backs don't get better with age.
So you're saying right now?
Right now.
Gotta go with Larry because he's...
Really?
Yeah, the outside shot. That doesn't leave.
Oh.
Yeah, but you gotta move.
I have seen Larry try to get up and down out of, like, a chair. And it can be a little
They're not
basic.
Running up and down the court, though. All you need to do
is... If you're doing 1-2 dribble limit we do, then maybe. But that's what it's about. It's Magic and Bird. It's still a conversation.
It's a debate for our time. Yeah. Adrian Wojnarowski reporting Ja Morant met with the top three teams in next month's draft on Wednesday. According to league sources, the Grizzlies are focused on Morant at number two overall. How high is his ceiling, Richard?
It is very, very high. I know we like to look at the dunks, but that part, you know, any athlete will tell you that stuff will go away. It's all the other things that he can do, the passing, the shooting, the understanding of an offense. That's what gets people excited. Like, those dunks are fun. Those are awesome. I'll be the first one to tell you it's my favorite thing in the world, but that's not what's going to make him a great player.
I mean, look, I think him and Jaren Jackson Jr. are something you get excited about.
Yeah, and also the opportunity to, now this gives you an opportunity to trade Mike Conley or have him there as a mentor for Ja in his first year.
Absolutely. All right, I want to turn our attention back to tonight's game right out there on the court. What needs to change for the Blazers tonight, Richard?
Well, I think their defense, I think they're going to bring Cantor up. They're going to bring Collins up. I think they wanted to try something. You saw Coach Stotts get a little fired up. Where he's like, well, were they double-teaming him when he went for 30 in the second half? And it's like, yes, you want to try different things. But I think for the most part, they're going to be a little bit more aggressive on Steph. And look, Andre Iguodala has a finals MVP for a reason. They do have other guys that can beat you. Mm-hmm. But the goal is to make those other guys beat you, not allow Steph and Klay to be the most dominant guys on the
Let's
court.
Let's not kid ourselves. Andre Iguodala has a finals MVP for defending LeBron James.
Yes, but he knocked down some really,
yes,
really
absolutely.
Big
and
shots.
Yes, absolutely. And he did in the other
game. Look, the Blazers looked tired to me in the first
game. Agree.
And I think the Warriors felt the same way. I was at practice yesterday, and a lot of the Warriors coaching staff was saying that the Blazers looked a lot like the Warriors looked last year after that Houston series that went seven games, game one against the Cavs, and any other game, the Warriors thought they should have lost that game one. Yep. They are expecting Portland to come out so much stronger in this game because you've had a minute to catch your breath, to get over that seven game series against Denver, and also after you just got routed in game one. That's a proud franchise.
I am looking for them to change their defense. I think they'll do that. And Terry Stotts, to his credit, apologized yesterday to the reporter Anthony later that he went after in that press conference.
Aww.
But I also offensively expect things to change. Damian Lillard has the heart of a guy who will make things happen. He has been doubled. He has been trapped. He has been beat up. They're physically going after him. And this has been happening for a while now. It happened for the second half of the Denver series as well. And we saw it with the Warriors. And I am very interested to see how he comes out tonight, how he's going to fight through all this, because this is his reality. It's not going to change.
No.
And he knows that this team, it still revolves around him. CJ McCollum is much better shot maker than he gets credit for. Great skill player, but still.
It's got to
be Damian Lillard.
He got to the free throw line 9 times last game. Got to keep getting to the free throw line.
All right, at the buzzer, Caesars has released its new odds for next year's NBA title. The Knicks keep going up.
Uh-huh.
Producer Steve is dancing in the control room right now. They are now the third best odds to win the title.
Knicks fans,
congratulations. The third best odds?
Yes.
Congratulations, Knicks.
Yes.
This is
the money
an amazing sucker bet.
I guarantee that the Knicks will have the third best odds today. Knicks are going
to
win a championship next year.
Listen,
I
if you want money to
it.
Throw away, just go ahead and give it to somebody else on the street.
Well, he just said that they're going to win.
Oh, they're going to win a championship. I guarantee it, Knicks
fans. This is amazing. Boom. We're here at Oracle. We'll be back tonight, 7 o'clock Eastern. No.